Educational Institute located in Coimbatore on the Palakkad Road near Ettimadai at the border of Kerala and Tamil Nadu state. This is a leading educational and research institute affiliated to Bharathiyar University, Coimbatore. It offers several UG and PG courses under the discipline of arts, science and social studies. It also offers MPhil and PhD programs in several courses. The institute started its educational service to the society since 1994 and completed its Silver Jubilee year and progressing its 26th year of academic excellence. The institution is run by Sri Narayana Guru Educational Trust SNGET, located at Sai Baba Colony, Coimbatore. The management office bearers are Sri N. Prabhakaran, Chairman, Sri P. M. Vasu, Secretary, Srimadi Sailaja Venu, Vice Chairperson, Srimadi Vijina Premnath, Joint Secretary, Sri P. A. Rajkumar, Treasurer. Dr. M. Ilangovan, the principal, Sri Narayana Guru College. He was the former HOD of Department of Biochemistry. He only established the department for the past 25 years and the credit goes to him. He supports and encourages and guides us on all our endeavors.
BSc Biochemistry, MSc Biochemistry, MPhil Biochemistry and PhD Biochemistry. Along with that, the department takes value-added courses, that is VAC, like nanobiotechnology, food and nutrition, clinical lab technology, computer-aided drug design and mushroom cultivation. The highlights of the department are well-equipped laboratories, ideal research environment, remarkable placements, industrial and educational visits regularly. Regularly, it takes gold medal and university ranks and 100% results.
Faculties of the department are Dr. K. Narayanaswamy, Associate Professor and Head. He has got 22 years of teaching experience. He is guiding a PhD scholar. His area of specialization, cancer biology and medicinal plants. Dr. N. Nirmala Devi, Associate Professor. She is having 15 years of teaching experience. She is guiding a PhD scholar. Her area of specialization, plant biochemistry. Dr. Radhi M.A., Assistant Professor, having 9 years of teaching experience. She is guiding a PhD scholar. Her area of specialization, cancer biology and medicinal plants. Dr. N. Sudarmani Gayatri, Assistant Professor, having 4 years of teaching experience and the area of specialization, clinical toxicology and plant therapeutics. Mr. S. Vinu Chakravarti, Assistant Professor of Chemistry. He is having 10 years of teaching experience and his area of specialization, organic chemistry. Ms. Ashley George, Assistant Professor. She is having 2 years of experience. Her area of specialization, cancer biology.
7 days alumni webinar series organized by the Department of Biochemistry. Day 5, the resource person of the day, Mrs. S.
சிவப்பிரியா, பிஹெச்டி ஸ்காலர், மணிப்பால் இன்ஸ்டிடியூட் ஆஃப் ரீஜெனரேட்டிவ் மெடிசன், எம்ஐஆர்எம், எம்ஏஹெச்சி, மணிப்பால், மேங்களூர். ஷி ஹேஸ் கம்ப்ளீட்டட் ஹர் பிஹெச்டி ஒர்க் அண்ட் ஷி இஸ் கோயிங் டு சப்மிட் த தீசிஸ் சூன். இன் திஸ் செஷன் ஷி இஸ் கோயிங் டு டெலிவர் எ லெக்சர் ஆன் ரீஜெனரேட்டிவ் மெடிசன் கரண்ட் அண்ட் ஃபியூச்சர் டைரக்ஷன்ஸ்.
College, behalf of our principal Dr. M. Ilangovan and behalf of the department, I extend a warm and happy welcome to Mrs. Sivapriya. Yes, Sivapriya, welcome.
So hello all, good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, thank you. So I was an alumni at SNGC from in BSc Biochemistry from 2009 to 12, and currently I am a PhD student at Manipal Institute of Regenerative Medicine, Manipal. So I'm just here to discuss with you a few facts about regenerative medicine. In layman terms, it's called stem cell therapy or stem cell research. So what is the current and future directions of the research? So let's move on. So you might have heard from your school days how an hydra regenerates, right? So just cut a hydra, put it into two pieces. The two pieces eventually grows into a two new organism. So this is some articles which is being published recently from 2018 to 20 Science Focus. Whenever you get time, go read this magazine. It is very interesting. So of wound healing. So maybe by end of this session, you will have some clues or cues, answer for these questions. Our quest towards why this regeneration is impossible in humans, or what does human possess? What ability of stem cells or regenerative capacity humans possess? So what is regenerative medicine? It involves the study which includes, or it is the science of studying the regeneration of human cells, tissues or organs in order to restore the normal function. So we are always, when a term regeneration is being coined up, we require another term simultaneously, that is the stem cell or the mother cell. So when you can define a cell to be a stem cell is when it has the capacity of self-renewal. It can renew itself to produce more and more of stem cells, as well as it should produce other types of cells. So in that case, you name that particular cell as stem cell. That is a single cell which is able to replicate its produce enormous stem cell bank, at the same time also to produce various tissue types like neuron, muscle, blood, everything. Okay, so two features of stem cell is self-renewal and differentiation. Now you might have heard about the fertilization and formation of zygote. So we know an embryo has the capacity to generate into a complete new individual. A mass of cells can develop into a whole new adult or an individual. So we know here the Morula stage is the 3 to 4 day stage. 3 to 4 day stage wherein 3 to 4 day stage wherein this phase of your life or any embryonic life is said to be a totipotent stage. So potential to develop into any tissues of your body. This cells, this group of cells can develop into anything, whether it's heart, hair, nails, liver, kidney, anything. So they are very potent and hence named as totipotent. When it reaches to 5 to 7 days or the blastocyst stage, this is the time when even IVF, the IVF clinics take the embryo and implant it into uterus. So in this stage, it becomes little more differentiated. It is losing its little more potency to develop into a complete individual. Here it becomes pluripotent. This outer layer called trophoblast, it becomes the placenta, and this inner layer called the inner cell mass becomes the whole new embryo. Now this inner cell mass again is completely pluripotent. It can even develop into whole new set of cells except placenta. Now, next is 8 weeks, an embryo is formed, then comes the fetus, then comes the adult. So in adult also, there are stem cells. So have you heard of that? Whether adult has a stem cell pool? So where do these stem cells reside? Any idea? Or only embryo has? So adult also has stem cell pool. That also we will see now. Okay. So stem cell type, whether it is totipotent when it is early, that is 1 to 3 day stage, pluripotent 5 to 14 days, and multipotent is your adult tissues from where you can take out the cells or the stem cells. Now, as I said, there are stem cells can be broadly classified into two. One is adult derived and another one is embryonic. So the embryonic is a totipotent or pluripotent in nature. Adult is hematopoietic or the blood stem cell and the mesenchymal stem cell. So the blood stem cells can be derived from the umbilical cord blood of the embryo or from the bone marrow in the larger bones like hip bone, your femur bone. So in from that bone, you can derive the bone marrow and you can inject it back. Even now it is practiced clinically, the adult bone marrow stem cell transplantation in cases of blood cancer patients. So we will see that, okay? And what are embryonic stem cells? First, we will start with embryonic stem cells. So the embryonic stem cells are derived from the 5 to 6 day blastocyst. So you take out this inner cell mass and culture it on a culture dish, and it can be used to differentiate various tissues of your interest. So that case, it is called as embryonic stem cells. And this is only legally allowed to do the from the or to collect the embryos from the in vitro clinics. So you cannot abort the fetus. It is ethically, it cannot be practiced. So the embryonic stem cells are derived from inner cell mass, and it is a great potency. Okay. And here you can see, this is how an embryonic stem cell under the dish looks like. Okay. This is a manifestation at 20x. It looks like this. And embryonic stem cells can be marked or labeled by certain markers. They are NANOG, OCTFO, SSCA4, TRA1. Just by starting culturing, you have to characterize them. You cannot simply tell that, oh, these embryonic stem cells are growing. You have to characterize them. For that, you have to see for the expression of certain markers. This is the immunofluorescent image of embryonic stem cell markers like NANOG, OCTFO, SSCA4, and TRA1. These are all nuclear markers. And you can also see a dye here, DAPI. This is a common dye which is used to label the nucleus. Okay, it will take up any cell's nucleus or DNA. It will bind to the DNA of any cell's nucleus. So this DAPI will be a common dye which is being found in any IF images. So from this seminar onwards, you should be able to understand that DAPI is a common dye, just a dye to label the nucleus. And this one is the characteristic specialized markers, okay, the antibodies thrown against specialized markers. So what are the limitations of embryonic stem cells? So ethical, political issues, as I stated, because it's like killing a new life, killing an embryo. So that is one ethical and political issue. And another one is a potential teratoma. So whenever you inject, you cannot use it for a therapy, because whenever you inject into a mice or a human, it has a threat of forming teratoma. So how teratoma differs from carcinoma is, teratoma means, carcinoma is a particular type of a cancer of one cell, but teratoma is a cancer of multiple cell types, because embryonic stem cell is able to differentiate into a multiple cell type. From teratoma, you can derive a hair cell, you can derive a tooth, means a dental dentins, you can derive hepatocyte, you can derive anything out of teratoma. So it is a cancerous mass of every cell type of your body. So that is big threat of injecting embryonic stem cell. And apart from that, as we all know, like in any other transplantation, whether you do kidney or any other transplantation of organs, there is a threat of immune rejection. So similar to that, here also, when you inject embryonic stem cells of some other donor, the host might develop certain immune rejection reactions. So that is also another limitation of using embryonic stem cells as a source of therapy. Okay, so it is a particular group of cells where you can exclusively use it for research to study the developmental biological aspects, how a heart develops, how a liver develops. So you just seed the embryonic stem cells, you just take it to the develop, or you can take it to a developing cardiac system or a hepatic system or a renal system. You can study all the developmental biology part, or it is a great tool for research, not for therapy. Now, next set of stem cell, or which can be derived from the adult, not an embryo, but an adult, as well as from umbilical cord blood, is the hematopoietic stem cells. So here, it is already in clinics. It is practiced as a clinical therapy for the cancer patients who have undergone myeloablative chemotherapy for leukemia and other blood cancers. So before undergoing chemotherapy, the patient's bone marrow will be aspirated and it will be stored, and all the cells will be stored there. And after chemotherapy, the same cells will be injected back. And these cells has also the HSCs, or the hematopoietic stem cells, which have the ability to form new blood cells in the cancer patients. So these are more differentiated. They are not like embryonic stem cells. They are much more differentiated and they can only form blood cells. So HSCs have the ability to form all the neutrophils, lymphocytes, RBCs, all the blood cells it can form. So this is one form of adult stem cells, which is already in clinical therapy for plasma cell dyscrasias or any other blood cancers. And now moving on to the major attention, and the major attention on which I am working on also, and major attention, which is wherever you see stem cell therapy, it is nothing but it is MSC therapy, mesenchymal stem cell therapy. So mesenchymal stem cells is one potential source of stem cells. It was discovered in 1968 as one colony forming unit. It was just named as colony forming unit by Fredenstein. And it is isolated from various sources from an adult. See, from bone marrow, from peripheral blood, from umbilical cord. This is what you might have seen advertisements. When a newborn baby is born, just store its umbilical cord. You might have heard that advertisement. It is nothing but the MSCs, the mesenchymal stem cells, are being stored for later for any other treatment purposes of that baby when it becomes an adult or so. But then Wharton's jelly, umbilical cord, decidua basalis, that's your skin, ligamentum flavum, placenta, amniotic fluid, dental pulp, breast milk, adipose tissue, so enormous bone marrow, enormous sources are there. And what are the features of this MSC is they are highly immunomodulatory. So whenever you inject an MSC into a site of inflammation, it has a capacity to reduce inflammation. So it will reduce inflammation as such. So hence, MSCs are now highly practiced in curing arthritis. So they just inject it into the joints, and you can see the reduction in the inflammation in the menisci. So similarly, they can modulate the T cells, B cells with certain cell-to-cell interaction. They can fight apoptosis, they can increase angiogenesis, they can even form various tissues, and in vitro and in vivo studies are happening, and we will see more in the next slides. So here, this is the flow cytometric analysis of MSC. As soon as you isolate MSC from any tissue of your interest, this is BMMSC stands for bone marrow MSCs, DPSC stands for from dental pulp. So whenever you take out this MSC, you have to characterize them. Like ESCs have certain markers, MSCs also have certain markers, because it will be contaminated with various other cells like fibroblasts, normal human fibroblastic cells. So markers of MSCs are 90, 105. It should not have 34 and 45. 34 and 45 are positively expressed by HSCs, hematopoietic stem cells. 34 and 45 are usually expressed by blood cells or blood stem cells, and not by MSCs, mesenchymal stem cells or mesenchymal stromal cells. Similarly, with the PCR, you can also check with the real-time PCR or a normal reverse transcriptase PCR, you have to check the expression of these markers. You can see a band 105-73-90. It is negative for 34-45. This is a housekeeping gene, that is gap DH. You might have studied it in the glycolytic pathway where glyceraldehyde phosphate dehydrogenase is being stated. So this gap DH is used as a housekeeping gene in molecular biology experiments. So go back and read about it. How come it is used as a housekeeping gene? So this is how MSC looks under 20x image under a phase contrast microscope. Similarly, see, when you isolate an MSC, you have to further characterize it. Not only these markers, you also characterize them whether they are able to differentiate into adipogenic, chondrogenic, osteogenic. So whether they are able to form bone, whether they are able to form cartilage, whether they are able to form fat tissue. So provided certain proteins and factors onto the culture, they all express this kind of multiple lineage specificities. So what are the advantages of MSCs over any other or mesenchymal stem cells or embryonic stem cells is ease of isolation. It can be easily isolated. There is no issue of any embryo isolation or anything. There is no teratoma formation as such because they itself are immunomodulatory. Then there is a very less immunogenicity and they have a high homing potential. Homing potential, nothing but when you inject it anywhere, it can sense an inflammatory site and go there. So migration. So it can easily migrate. So that's why MSC is considered to be one of the important salient feature. Even during COVID-19 in US, there are trials going on to treat corona with stem cell therapy. That is nothing but the MSC therapy, mesenchymal stem cell therapy. So you can check in this site, okay, once the seminar is over. If you're interested, just go and check. clinicaltrials.gov is a website which gives how many ever clinical trials are going all around the world. So to date, about 367 MSC-based clinical trials are going on in humans. Okay, so you can see for various diseases, you can see here bronchopulmonary dysplasia, diabetic nephropathy, neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, so many diseases, the mesenchymal stem cell therapy is going on. So you can check this site, clinicaltrials.gov, which is run by NIH with help of US National Library of Medicine. Now, apart from stem cells, now the recent advancement is not only the stem cells. So when you grow a stem cell in the cultured media, cultured dish, you have a liquid, okay, a nutrient medium which you supply for the growth of the cells. So once you grow these stem cells in that media, you can just isolate the media in which these cells are grown, which itself act as a big reservoir of the growth factors and proteins that is being secreted by the stem cells during its growth. So the secretome itself acts, or this media itself act as a big reservoir of a growth factor pool. So now this media alone is enough. So research is going on and this media is termed as conditioned medium. So this research is going on whether this conditioned medium itself is enough. The medium in which the stem cell has been grown, not even the cells. So that is enough. It is seen to be highly protective to curb various inflammation and diseases. And apart from that, there is furthermore condensation. From the media, they have isolated 3-kilodalton protein. You might have heard about microvesicles, exosomes. That is a protein part, 3-kilodalton, 10-kilodalton part. They have condensed it. Only that part they have taken out from the media, that is the protein part, and they have used it for treating of various diseases. So now the research has come from stem cells to stem cell grown media to stem cell exosomes. Okay. So now, as I said, see, so many studies from 2007, the study of stem cell mediated, condition medium mediated studies are happening. So primary neuronal cultures, when it was exposed to BMMSC condition medium, the amyloid beta peptide induced apoptosis, that is Alzheimer mediated, okay, study in a concentration dependent manner, it was able to protect the bone marrow condition medium. Similarly, here also mouse cortical neurons, with conditioned media, it could also prevent excitotoxicity. Excitotoxicity is nothing but epilepsy. So similar to that, so many studies are there with conditioned media. Now, as I stated, extracellular vesicles or exosomes. Okay, now instead of injecting big cells, we can inject 100 nanometer particles. So EVs, extracellular vesicles, which are released by the cells, are classified into exosome, microvesicles, and apoptotic bodies. So this exosome, this is a picture of an exosome in 100 nanometer resolution under tandem electron microscopy. So these exosomes it consists of a lipid enclosed or the plasma membrane bilayer kind of enclosure with miRNA, mRNA, shRNA in it. So this miRNA is nothing but a transcription factor. So that itself is enough to go and start or trigger a gene or start and switch on and off a gene. So exosome itself was found to be protective in various diseases. Now, next, moving on from MSCs to iPSCs. So this is a new set of very, very interesting field, which is rapidly gaining research, and future of stem cell therapy or stem cell research will be, I think, 50% will be taken over by induced pluripotent stem cells. So have you ever thought, once an adult is formed, can you go back to the cues of your own embryo? That is, just take a skin cell and can you go back to your own embryonic state? But answer was yes. For this, Yamanaka was awarded Nobel Prize in 2012. Just take a skin fibroblast, skin cells from your skin, and just put four factors, four proteins, and they will form the embryonic stem cell kind of features. They will show up such kind of features. So those four factors which Yamanaka described was KLF4, SOX2, c-MYC, and NANOG. OCT4, SOX2, c-MYC, and KLF4. Even NANOG is not necessary. So these four factors here I have mentioned, OCT4, SOX2, c-MYC, KLF4. So these four factors, just you put it into the medium in which your adult fibroblast cells can grow, it can just reprogram. So this research was called as reprogramming approach. You can reprogram your adult cells into an embryonic cell fate. So as I stated, embryonic stem cells will express all the four markers, NANOG, OCT4, SOX2, and all those markers. Similar to that, this iPS also will start expressing all the embryonic stem cell markers. Now this iPS can be used to differentiate into various cells like your cardiomyocyte, adipocyte, dopaminergic neural cells, and many other cells. So this was a big breakthrough, the stem cell. These cells are called iPSCs or induced pluripotent cells, derived from normal fibroblast cells, which are derived from any part, maybe skin or any part of small tissue you can take. So here, as they stated, when you reprogram them, they start expressing all the embryonic stem cells. Markers like NANOG, OCT4, SSCA4, TRA1. So you just verify whether they are reprogrammed, whether whatever factors we have put have triggered them to reprogram, or they are just in their fibroblast stage or in a non-embryonic stage. So you just have to verify that before you confirm it as iPSC. So these are the four factors. And as I stated, we put a normal dye which labels the nucleus of every cell, or in any fluorescent imaging you will see a dye called DAPI, which is nothing but you just throw it into the cells and it will just bind to the DNA of the cells. Okay, so they are the marker of the nucleus. So iPSCs have been extensively used to model human diseases in petri plate. So you can generate a precision medicine approach with iPSC. See, if I am different, you are different, or anybody is different. So you can just take my fibroblast and generate my embryonic state. Next person's fibroblast can be in the same way taken out and can be generated into embryonic state. So many research is going on Parkinson's. Okay, taking out the fibroblast, skin fibroblasts from Parkinson's patient, generating iPSCs from them and studying what is happening, what mutations have been happening with their neural lineage. Okay, generate iPSCs, put them into a neural or neural lineage or neural system differentiation, and then study on a Parkinson's patient and see what all deletions and mutations have occurred with that patient that is going on. So it is with respect to iPSCs, again, they have also a problem with teratoma formation. So they cannot be ideally used for therapy, even though most of the scientists claim that they can be used for therapy, but still it has to be explained. That fact has to be explained, whether it will form teratoma, but they will be a very good source for the research purpose, okay, to study. So what are the future perspectives of this stem cell therapy or regenerative medicine is a biomaterial and tissue engineering is being combined now. So stem cell therapy is being combined with a collagen based scaffold, 3D bioprinting to generate a whole new organ like a heart, kidney. You can see, you can just go and see the amount. You just type in Google 3D bioprinting with stem cells. You can see the amount of work, research work that is going on with respect to that field. And cell therapy in conjunction with this tissue engineering, ESC and IPSC is a very good model for studying developmental biology, proteins, okay, and IPSCs which offer a big hope for precision medicine, okay, the medicine system where an individual care can be taken out, that is precision to you only, and drug testing for testing various drugs, okay, on cardiomyocytes, on neurons, or on fibroblasts. You can generate those lineages from these stem cells and you can test the drugs. Okay, and MSC therapy are in preclinical stages. As I told, MSC therapy are already for various diseases are in human trials now. And a lot of research is going on the secretome, the benefits of secretome, the exosome. Nowadays, what they are doing, they are loading the drugs with exosome. And they are the MSC exosomes are being loaded with drugs and given as therapy. So it is a beneficial effect of both drug and MSC exosomes reaching into the target. So, and research on basic biology of stem cells are also happening. And stem cell research labs in India, one lab in STEM, which is a part of National Center for Biological Sciences, Bangalore, which functions exclusively to do the stem cell research in India. And there is NIMHANS, where neural stem cell research is going on, which is very, very interesting. They study about adult neurogenesis also. Because brain, there is only two stem cell niches in brain. One is your subventricular zone, other one is your subgranular zone. So some interesting work is going on with NIMHANS, ICER Pune, TAFR Mumbai, Anna University Chennai, RGCB Trivandrum, National Brain Research Center Gurgaon, and much more. So there are so many stem cell research institutes which are functioning. If you are really interested, you can go start working in it. And IPSC is one such interesting field. So thank you so much. If you have any questions, you can ask me.
Shivapriya?
Yes, sir.
You said about getting these embryonic stem cells from the adult cells. That is, it is something like going reverse of embryogenesis.
Yes, sir.
Is it possible?
Yes, sir. That is called induced pluripotent stem cells, or iPSC.
Mm-hmm. And what about the tissues present in umbilical cord? You see that our own answer?
That is MSC, sir. That is mesenchymal stem cells, adult stem cells they are. This is like just take your fibroblast from skin, just normal fibroblastic cell, not a stem cell, normal skin cell. And just put these four factors, KLF4, c-MYC, OCT4, SOX2. Then they just revert, sir. They just revert it into an embryonic state. That means that in adult cells, all these genes are silenced. When they start differentiating one by one, they are getting silenced, sir. That's what Yamanaka got Nobel Prize for.
Oh, that genes has to be activated.
Activated.
Oh, then only it will revert back.
Revert back, sir.
Okay. Research is going on that area.
Yes, sir. Even in our lab, we are working on iPSC, sir. They just become like an embryonic stem cell only, sir. When you put these four factors in 1 week, you keep on giving media change, they just attain that embryonic stem cell-like features and they start expressing that markers.
What you're doing?
See, you know, I am a person who is into research. And you know, about as a friend, you know, I was usually the age they tell for girls, I married little late only because I was pursuing, I registered for my PhD, then got married.
Yes. So,
I think if you're really passionate and if you really want to, you can have everything whenever you want. It's like it's not research or PhD is not going to be a big barrier for your personal life. You can actually manage both of them easily if you have support.
Pretty
from
good. Yes.
For me,
yes.
You know how my family supports me. So right. If you have family support, your family, and if you are not so much if a hormonal variation or anything, PhD is a very stressful thing. 6 to 7 years of stress you have to undergo. But you should be able to keep that pace. You should be able to keep that pace. You should take care of your body. You should keep yourself fit. Then I don't think the marriage or whatever things later on should affect you. And if you're really passionate about science, you'll feel it as a big barrier. It is stressful, but you will come back. You will revert back.
Right. But then, you know, everything comes with effort only. So if you take effort, the result will be also like that.
And you know, I ask you every time, you know, right? I ask you, tell me some asanas to reduce stress.
We'll give you. I'm going to conduct a free session. Actually, this is a Zoom meeting is limited so that I cannot go with some asanas or detail with the details. Yeah. So we will have a session, a free session on asanas that will give a quick relief to your stress and manage your what stress.
Yeah.
We will conduct one full day session, Achu. We'll contact one full day session. So do the workout also. You can do some workouts also.
Sure. I will come to college after the COVID-19. Then we will have a beautiful session so that I can assist you. So if you have any mistake, I cannot control with this mobile. So if I am present lively, then I can do well. Sure, we will come.
Okay, sure, Rachel.
Ma'am is there. Okay, Shivapriya, one more question.
Yeah.
Actually, you're there. Okay. Actually, why you choose an stem cell research as your topic? Because people are choosing other topics like nowadays. Why you choose this topic?
When I was studying BSc biochemistry, I don't remember whether Radhi ma'am told me, Narayana Swami sir told me. I don't remember. One person, somebody from our college told me that Amrita has medical biochemistry. Harisa told me, I don't remember, but one person told that MSc medical biochemistry is there in Amrita. So I was like, okay, it's more related to clinical biochemistry, so I can swing there. So I went there. I was studying clinical biochemistry. So during that time, again, stem cell, this part of studies and all came up. So at that time, I was so fascinated. Really, I went because of the interest. I didn't go because I got a seat or I got a PhD in stem cell research, I'll go. No, I just searched. I wanted stem cell research and I went. So during that time, I was fascinated because at that time, we just know the fact that there is stem cell in our body, which has the capability to produce other cell types and which has the capability to renew itself. This much only we know. For a BSc student. So then I was like, okay, this is very interesting. And it was a booming field. It's like, even now it's just beginning.
Yeah, it got a very good future.
Yeah. So I just, okay. Then I was searching where to go. Then I found that it's there in Manipal. So even in Amrita, it was not, the research work was not going on so much. So in Manipal, it was one. So I just choose here and research unit called Stemputics. There already they are working on clinical trials and lot of patenting works and all they are doing. So I just came and it is like it just took off like that. And during which IPSC research and all those happened.
Sujit is there.
Sujit, no. Yes, Sujit is there, but he is not in this Zoom session. Maybe he is there.
Yeah, now he came.
He came. I didn't see him.
Okay. Shivapriya, as
yes,
an
ma'am.
Alumni, what you are going to tell? Tell something about our college. What you have learned?
No, the Any best take home? Time, the best time, whatever it is, it was the best time. Those 3 years, you might have a lot of complaints now, I know. For this small complaints you will have now. But whatever it is, those 3 years are best time. And all my best friends, this Achu, this Nandu, all these guys, we all are in contact. And all those best friends are from SNGC. And that's why when any of you ask me to come back, I'll just come back. Because I love SNGC and all my department. Everywhere I have a memory, in lab, in the classrooms. At that time, the strength was also very less, ma'am, if you remember.
Yeah, yeah.
Only 13.
13, I think. Mm.
Yes, yes. Strength was also very less. So, I don't know, we had a lot of time for interaction, faculties also. So, it's all nice memories. And it will be the best time. You will remember it.
Yeah, yeah.
Always.
Shivapriya,
yes, sir.
What is your advice or suggestions to the present UG or PG students, our students?
If you are really passionate, they should continue working, sir. Maybe like little setbacks will be there. When you go out of this place, you might face students who are coming out even from IITs. When you come to outer places like Bangalore, when you just put yourself into cities, you'll feel like they're all, sometimes even the persons who are doing PhD with me are B.Techs. B.Tech in biomedical engineering, genetic engineering. So sometimes you will feel little low, or you might feel that we are fit, or we will be able to do it. But actually, we will be able to do it. Everything is very easy once we learn. So I just have to tell people that if you are really passionate, continue, don't stop studying. Even if it might be little late, you can go for a job, then come back, resume education. There is nothing like you went to job, you should not study. You should continue and you should resume back. And our field is like, it will take a lot of time to settle and to learn and to establish yourself, but it's worth it. It is such a beautiful place. When you come out, you'll understand biochemistry, whatever you're studying. I'm so happy, sir, I took biochemistry, because today, even though we are not known purely as biochemists, but it is there. Biochemistry is there everywhere. Even if you take regenerative medicine, it's full of biochemistry. Biochemistry and molecular biology. So wherever you go, biochemistry is going to help you if you are in this field. And when you go to National Institute, there is no problem. You can learn every technique, everything within a month. It is not at all tough. So even though a little setback is there, you should continue. You should not leave. And our field is one evergreen field. It will not have a fall until there is disease or there is health science or science, as such biological science. Our field is always, it will be evergreen. You will have postdoc positions. You will have PhD positions. So once you are set in, it might take little time, but once you are set in, it will be all fine. So if you are really passionate, you should continue studying.
Rightly said, Shivapriya. So thank you for the suggestions. It goes to only our students. Okay, on behalf of our college, the management, the principal, Dr. M. Ilangovan, on behalf of our department, so I would like to extend a great thanks to Shivapriya. In spite of her busy schedule doing PhD work, she accepted our invitation. And she has presented a very nice topic on stem cell research. So we are all happy and very proud to attend this session done by our own student. So thank you very much, Shivapriya, for accepting our invitation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Shivapriya. Okay, bye, sir.
Then I would like to thank our management and the principal, Dr. M. Ilangovan, for giving us permission to conduct this webinar series. Thank them all. Then once again, I thank all my faculty, colleagues, and the students and the participants
for attending and organizing this event. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.